Thank you for watching today's sermon from St. Matthew's Lutheran Church in Stoddard. Our message today is...
Please stand. Grace and peace are yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Listen again to the words of our second lesson, which will serve as our meditation this morning. From 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 21. Peter writes, "For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory saying, 'This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard that voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things, for prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." This is the word of our Lord. You may be seated. Dear believers who have received the precious gift of faith through the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. As parents are traveling around with young children, especially on longer trips, speaking from experience now, many parents try to find games that you can play in the car that will keep their children entertained and, behaving along the trip. One of those games that we've played a few times is called I Spy, where someone in the car will look and see something and they'll say, "I spy something red." And then the rest of the people in the car have to guess what that thing is, and they keep guessing and guessing until someone finds out what it is, and then that person who guessed correctly is the next spy, and they have a turn picking something for everyone else to guess. It's not really a very difficult game. It's not really very challenging. Anyone who knows their colors can play, adults and children alike, but it keeps the kids entertained and it passes the time. It also keeps your eyes up on the scenery that's passing by the windows of your car. And that's actually part of the challenge of the game, is that when you spy something outside the car, it's usually passing by rather quickly. So you have to be alert. You have to be watching in order for you to see the thing that the spy has in mind. You got to get a quick glimpse of it or it's gone. So you need to watch carefully and stay alert. We need to stay alert today and throughout the Lenten season that's coming ahead. We need to watch closely to see what Peter is pointing out to us in our second lesson this morning. Jesus' transfiguration was an incredibly important and very encouraging event for these disciples right before they watched their Savior go to Jerusalem to suffer and die. You know, there are really very few events in the life of Jesus that are recorded in all four Gospels. The transfiguration account is recorded in three, but John and Peter, who were there that day of transfiguration, also mention seeing Jesus' glory there on the mountain in their writing. So five times then in the Bible, this event is pointed to as something very, very important. And it reminds us, these accounts of Jesus' transfiguration tell us, I spy, keep your eyes open, I spy God's glory in our humble Savior. And as we prepare to follow our Savior Jesus to the cross during the Lenten season, it's oh so important that we look carefully and quickly and remember this glory that he shows us here on the Mount of Transfiguration. Soon it will be gone. And soon Jesus' glory will be placed by humility and suffering and death. So as followers of Christ, we recognize that glory that God has revealed to us in the Scriptures, and then we revere our Savior, our Lord and Savior, as he goes to the cross and even especially on his way to the cross. Peter wrote this letter that we have recorded as the second Peter to Christians who needed to be reminded of the glory of their suffering Savior. He tells us in this letter that there were false teachers that had made their way into this Christian church that he was writing to, and they were teaching destructive heresies that took away from the glory of our sovereign Lord. And these false teachers accused Peter, Paul, and the other apostles of just making up fancy stories that they told to people about their friend Jesus. Some things haven't changed in 2,000 years, have they? Many people today, sadly, even in Christian churches, teach that much of what is written in the Bible isn't 100% reliable and true, and certainly not God's holy and powerful word. But Peter knew that those Christians needed to be confident in what they read and heard from the apostles about their Savior, that he truly was the one he said he was, the glorious Son of God. And we, too, need to be regularly reminded of Jesus' glory as the Son of God here in a world today that wants to strip away the glory of Jesus, our Savior, and make him out to be just a great guy and a really awesome teacher. He is so much more. And he shows us today on the Mount of Transfiguration, and Peter reminds us of that event so that we remember and cling to that glory that he is our holy God and our perfect Savior from sin, because as anything less than our holy God, he could not have been our Savior from sin. Peter specifically points to that awesome sight on Jesus' Mount of Transfiguration as the undeniable proof that Jesus is who Peter and Jesus said he was, and that the words of Peter and the rest of the apostles, all of the words that they told about Jesus, are trustworthy and true. Even the words of the prophets in the Old Testament can be trusted, as Peter tells us today. And of course, Peter could have pointed to any of the awesome miracles that Jesus did throughout his ministry, and we've seen some of them during the season of Epiphany. Jesus turned water into wine, fed 5,000 people, fed 4,000 people with just a few loaves of bread and some fish. Jesus healed someone who was blind, healed the lepers. Jesus healed people who couldn't walk. Again and again, we see Jesus showing his glory. Peter could have pointed to any of those miracles, but then again, you know, just like people do today, even in Jesus' day when he did those great and awesome miracles, people found ways to discredit and disbelieve what Jesus was doing. But Jesus' transfiguration drives home the truth of his glory that has been revealed to us during the Epiphany season. How could Peter be so sure that Jesus really was the Son of God, that Jesus really is the Son of God and not just a great teacher or some miracle worker? What evidence did he have that was beyond the shadow of a doubt to convince his hearers and listeners? Peter was there. He saw it with his own eyes. He had seen Jesus transformed in all of his glory, and his face shining like the sun, his clothes as bright as the light. Jesus, Peter, and the others heard the voice of God speaking from heaven, just as he had done at Jesus' baptism. "This is my Son, whom I love. Listen to him." Jesus clearly is the eternal Son of God. Peter tells us in these verses that that voice that he and the other disciples heard on that mountain came from the majestic glory of God. And stop for a moment here, and I want you to think about that cloud of God's majestic glory. In our first lesson, it mentioned Moses going up on Mount Sinai. And there was the glory of God in a cloud as he went up there to receive the Ten Commandments. That same cloud descended on Mount Sinai. The cloud of God's glory was also there with the people of Israel as they moved through the wilderness. It would camp down. It would hunker down over the tabernacle tent that the people made as their place of worship for the Lord, and it would up and move when it was time for the people to move on. When Solomon dedicated his great temple to the Lord in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, the glory of the Lord descended on that temple and filled it with this great cloud so that the people, the priests who were going in, had to wait. They couldn't go in and do their jobs because the glory of the Lord was so powerfully there, and fire came down from heaven and received the offering that they put on the altar. And here again, on the Mount of Transfiguration, we see the glory of God, or we hear of the glory of God, surrounding his people. It seems as though this cloud of God's glory appears most often in Scripture at times when God is graciously and mercifully dwelling with his people. There on the mountain as he gave them his covenant. There in the tabernacle where the people would go to meet with the Lord. There in the temple as God accepted their offerings. And here on the Mount of Transfiguration, we see most clearly how God dwells graciously with his people. There in Jesus himself was God living, dwelling with his people. Jesus was here on this earth as the atoning sacrifice to bring God and his people back together so that our sins would no longer separate us from him. It is from this cloud that Peter, James, and John heard the voice declare with certainty, Jesus is the beloved Son of God who has pleased him with his perfect life in our place. And the words of Holy Scripture, from which we hear and learn Jesus' glory, those words that Peter and the other holy writers passed on down to us, come to us from the very same source. They come to us from God's glory, the Word of God revealing himself to his people with us here on earth. The Word that we read about in our Bibles and here at church testifies about Jesus, revealing him to us, which is exactly what God sent the Holy Spirit in this world to do. These words are trustworthy and true. They're not the imagination of some naive fishermen who were easily hoodwinked by a crafty teacher. Peter, here in these words, gives us one of the clearest explanations of how God's word was given to those men for them to write it down. He says, "Prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." We call the words of the Bible holy and inerrant, because they were given by God through the Holy Spirit to the men who wrote them down. He gave them the very words that they should write, and they wrote them down without a single error. Jesus assures us in the Gospels that not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen would ever disappear from what God told them to write. We need to understand and believe that what God has caused to be written down in his word is his words exactly, so that we can trust his every promise and his gracious presence among us. There was no doubt in Peter's mind that Jesus is the very Son of God, the glorious Son of God. He believed it with all of his heart. And that truth changed the rest of Peter's life forever. Peter wrote this letter to these Christians very near to the end of his life. In fact, very close to our text, he tells us that the Lord has made known to him that he is about to set his body aside. He is about to die and go to be with the Lord in heaven. Peter and the rest of the apostles lived their lives dedicated to the word that the Lord had given them, that he had taught to them by the Holy Spirit. 11 of the apostles gave their lives so that they could to continue preaching God's word when they were commanded not to. They were martyred. And John, the only one who lived, according to tradition, the only one who lived and died of old age, was himself persecuted and could have been killed at many times. He was willing to give his life. These men would not have been willing to do this if this was some fanciful story that they made up. All of them were willing to give their lives for the Lord. They knew that this was that important, and they were convinced that Jesus is the glorious Son of God. Peter reminds us that we have the prophetic message as something completely reliable. And yet, you and I don't always live the same confidence and dedication that Peter and the apostles showed in that same message. We show our lack of confidence in God's word to work powerfully in our hearts when we don't eagerly hear and learn God's word, confident that it will do its work within us, strengthening our faith day after day, year after year, as Peter says, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. As Peter wrote later in this letter, it is the Christian's goal for every single one of us that we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we show a lack of trust in God's word. We show a lack of appreciation for the power and glory that is there in his word, in his glory revealed to us when we don't make that word part of our daily lives, at home and at church, at worship together as well as in our daily living. As God commanded his people in the Old Testament to make it part of their lives when they get up and when they lie down, when they leave their homes and when they come back and as they walk along the road, there's never a time in our lives when we should be separated from the hearing and learning of God's word. Make it part of your lives. Soak in it, and you will see God's power revealed in the strengthening of your faith. We also show a lack of trust in God's powerful word when we don't eagerly share the good news with others. When we fear that we fumble too much with our words for God to make use of us bringing that powerful gospel to others. When we're afraid to tell someone else about the Savior because we don't truly believe that the gospel works powerfully in people's hearts. We've all passed up opportunities when we could have shared the good news of the gospel. And I believe that pastors have more opportunities at that than the rest of us, and I've passed up a fair share of my own opportunities. I'm guilty just like every one of us is. And I won't share with you all of the times that I did pass up opportunities to share the gospel, but I do want to share with you one opportunity that I almost passed up. It was a few years back. I was taking an older couple through adult instruction classes, and the wife of this couple asked if it would be okay if her aged father and mother joined in these Bible classes. So I went to meet with her father and mother. I found out there's a little bit of a catch. Her father didn't want to have anything to do with our church. He knew a little bit about our church in the Wisconsin Synod, knew a little bit about what we teach, and he hated everything that he heard. So I thought, right away, I kind of wrote it off. I said, there's no way that this is going to go very well, but okay, if he's willing to sit down and sit through these classes because his daughter was pestering him to do it, we'll keep him in these classes and we'll talk about God's word. What can it hurt, right? This man was a 32nd degree Freemason and wanted to stay that way. He wasn't giving up that part of his life. So we started through the classes. During those classes, he was actually diagnosed with a brain tumor that was very quickly taking away his sight. But by the end of those classes, he told me he wanted to become a member of our church. That he saw that what we taught and what we teach here is the true word of God as the Lord passed it down to his apostles, as he had it written down. And that man even wrote the Freemasons a letter and said, okay, I'm done. I'm done being a Mason. I want to become a member of this church. And he joined our church just a few months before he died. I was very, very humbled by that experience. God's power at work, powerfully working in people's hearts. Not my fumbling words, not some great path of logic that I showed to this man, but God's word works in people's hearts. And you can trust that word to work in your heart. And as you share God's word, the light of the gospel, the joy of salvation in Jesus Christ to others, yes, even with your fumbling words, God works powerfully in other people's hearts and shares with them the joy of salvation. The Lord works through his word because God gave it power through the Holy Spirit. It is his word, and we can trust it to do God's powerful work. I have to wonder, for Peter and the other disciples who saw Jesus' glory on that mountain, would seeing and remembering Jesus' glory like that make it harder or easier for them to see Jesus suffer at the hands of his enemies? How about for you? In the weeks ahead, like Jesus' disciples, we will follow our Savior through the humility and shame that he endured that finally ended on the cross. We will remember how he was mocked and jeered, how it seems as though his enemies got the upper hand and that our enemy, the devil, seemed to get his way, with sinful men condemning our Savior Jesus to die on the cross. Throughout the season of Lent, we need to remember this glory that we see today. Cling to it. Remember that Jesus is the glorious and beloved Son of God who endured all that shame and scorn and finally his Father's wrath for you and me to save us from our sin. So repent of that sin and rejoice in what Jesus suffered for you, for your sake, to win for you eternal life. Just like Jesus' glory is hidden as he goes to the cross in suffering and humility, so too his followers, the disciples, and you and me today endure suffering and shame, although we are God's glorified and beloved children. You might think that those disciples would have refused to suffer scorn and affliction and persecution. After all, they were servants of the most holy God. And we might be tempted to think the same thing today. We are followers of the beloved and glorious Son of God, so God should glorify us in this life, should reveal his glory in us. But like Jesus, our suffering Savior, God has hidden his glory in his servants in humility. Sometimes the ones God loves the most often suffer a great deal in accordance with his will. And yet, even as we suffer, God promises that his glory lives in us and that one day his glory will be revealed to the entire world, just like Jesus' glory will once again be revealed when he comes on that last day to judge all the earth. Most of the things that we would point out in an I Spy game come and pass and are gone forever. But Jesus' glory that we spy today on the Mount of Transfiguration will come back. Peter assures us that it is so. God has told us in his powerful word that it will not fail to happen. And we can trust that our glory, which remains hidden for us for the time being, will be on full display for all others to see. No longer humble servants of a suffering Savior, but righteous, righteous saints of our glorious Lord. Amen. Please stand. And now grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen.
Thank you for watching today's message from St. Matthew's Lutheran Church in Stoddard. Join us for worship at the following times. Like us on Facebook, or visit our website for audio and video sermons, or to find out more about our congregation. God bless your week in the Lord.